Welcome, everybody. It's time for a pop quiz. In the World Schools Debating Championships format, can a team win based on style? Well, the answer is yes. Style is one of three distinct criteria for scoring in the WSDC format. The other two being, of course, content and strategy. So if a judge felt that the team was far more compelling and effective because of style, then the judge can happily give the win to that team. In fact, if a speaker had a higher content score and a higher strategy score, but the opposing speaker had a significantly higher style score, then the opposing speaker can still take the win in that particular exchange. Welcome to Style, a presentation by me, Samuel Myat San. A caveat before we start, this class is really meant for students who already have some exposure to debate and have some experience in this activity. If you are completely new to debate, this class is not for you. A little introduction before we continue. This is me with the debaters of Madrasa Al Maarif, and they're one of the schools that I coach, together with Anglo-Chinese Junior College, St. Margaret's Secondary School, Raffles Institution, and Mayflower Secondary School. In the past, I've also had the privilege of working with the debaters from Nanhua High School, Nanyang Girls High, Fairfield Methodist Secondary, and Chung Cheng High School in Yishun. I've been in debate for a very long time. This is me 20 years and 20 kilograms ago when I was debating for ACJC and I still had a jawline. I started debating in primary school and secondary school because I felt that I needed to improve my English. I was born in Myanmar, and when I came over to Singapore, I was way behind all of my peers in English and especially in spoken English. So I took up debate. But I really ended up loving the activity, not just for improving my English, but for improving my mind, critical thinking, and eventually committed to it as a lifelong passion. I continued debating for Anglo-Chinese School, Anglo-Chinese Junior College, and eventually here, as seen with my teammates, in Harvard College with the Harvard Speech and Parliamentary Debate Society. I then started coaching debate full-time in 2012, and you can see me here with one of my earliest teams in 2013 at the Prometheus Cup with ACJC, and you can see how much joy coaching brings to me. That's my happy face. But that wasn't my first job. I actually started out with the Singapore Foreign Service as a diplomat. This is me and my colleagues at the Singapore High Commission in New Delhi, staffing a visit from someone from Singapore. You might know that someone. One of the first things I had to do as a junior diplomat was to put up a submission for minister's approval. We had to follow a course of action in international relations. I can't tell you more than that, but we had to get minister's approval. And to do so, we had to provide some arguments. And my director was like, Sam, make sure you put forward good arguments. And I said, no problem. I'm a debater, I'm going to give him all of the arguments. So I kept putting in more and more rationales for our position, and each of these arguments ended up with 1, 2, 3 different sub-tiers, and I think that in the end, I had about 27 different points as to why we should take that position. I was feeling rather pleased with myself. I thought minister is going to be very impressed by the fact that I have exhausted all of the arguments we can think of. My director then said that was one of the worst ever submissions he's ever seen in his life. Thankfully, my director explained to me what went wrong. You see, Minister Giorgio was a busy man. He had a bunch of other submissions to go through, and he did not have time to read through 27 different points. He needed to know what the strongest arguments were. My director then explained that it wasn't just minister that we had to convince. If minister agrees, he then has to turn around and make the same arguments to cabinet. So the arguments that we provide for minister can't just be something that he agrees from the perspective of foreign affairs, but it has to be something that every minister and the prime minister was going to be able to get on board. So we had to be so selective in finding that one or two arguments which will be compelling for both minister as well as for cabinet. And I completely failed in this regard. Now, I think I know what happened. I was still fresh from my university debate circuit, and on the American Parliamentary Debate Association circuit where I was, they tended to put a lot of emphasis on just making sure there are a lot of points. Here is an example of a case that I used to run about whether the United States should intervene if China and Taiwan went to war. So you can see that within a 7-minute Prime Minister's constructive, I was still trying to shove in about 10 different points. And that unfortunately carried over into my working experience. That's when I realized, the things that I do in debate lingers and have an impact on the working world. And that's when I decided I have to look at debate in a different light. And that's when I decided we have to talk about style. We'll look at 5 things in today's video. First, what's the definition of style? 2, what's the state of style? How do we view style on the debate circuit right now? 3, why style is so important for you when it comes to your post-debate life? 4, how you can actually use style to improve your debating right now? And finally, some ways by which you can improve your style immediately. We can't really look at every single drill and exercise that will improve your style in this video. That's really going to take multiple training sessions, but we will look at some of the broad categories and we'll find other opportunities to talk about how to improve style in detail. Style is indeed subjective. It can be difficult to define. And there are 3 ways that people usually approach the definition of style, and I want to talk about some of the problems we have with that. The first and quite common method is to define style almost by synonym, where there is a simple definition which is almost a tautological definition of style. Style is the way people speak, the manner of your delivery. Now, this is a safe definition, but it doesn't really tell us anything. As a speaker, you don't quite know how to translate that into good speaking habits and into style. So usually tournament briefings and books try to improve on that by adding a second layer, which is definition by negation. That means you tell people what style is not about. You typically hear that style is not about accent, it is not about vocabulary, it's not about the way that you dress. That helps. That makes it a little bit more narrow, but at the same time, you know what not to do, but as a speaker, you don't know what good style still is, because you just know the areas to avoid, and you just have to assume that everything else that's left is good, but that's not true. And finally, to make it even tighter, a third layer may be added, which is definition by example. This is where you try to tell people, this is good style, look at it and do it. So you might hear things like it's slow delivery, it is about having good pauses, and all of that is true. You also see people telling, oh, that's a good speaker. You try to speak like him or try to speak like Martin Luther King, Abraham Lincoln, or Margaret Thatcher. This one is also problematic because 1, you have a non-exhaustive list of things that you can do to improve your style, but you're very much limited to only a few things that you can talk about in the briefing. And 2, you may actually end up with a lot of inconsistencies on what is considered good style as well. So all of these 3 combined can be useful, but they all still have their own limitations. I like to use 2 criteria for assessing style. The first criteria is, was the speech clear? That means, did I receive 100% of what the speaker intended to say? To me, an argument has 0 impact if I didn't hear it, or if I misheard it and I completely misinterpreted that particular argument. So you need to ensure 100% transmission success in order to make sure that your logical persuasion can be effective. The second criteria is, was the speech convincing? Are you able to use emotional and psychological persuasion through your speech in order to augment the logical persuasion that you've already used with your content? And those are the two simple criteria I have for style. Let's talk about what it means to have a speech that is clear. I'm going to focus on four elements that we can control to make our speeches so much clearer, but this is a non-exhaustive list. There are so many other things that we can do, but these four, they're pretty important. The first thing is controlling your pace. Singaporean speakers are known to speak very quickly. We're a little bit kiasu, so we want to get every single thing out as fast as possible. Now that can become a problem because when you're racing ahead, you end up tripping over your words, you end up essentially rushing through your delivery to the point where some words are just not heard by the judges. You end up having to put in a lot more filler words, such as like, right, we see that, all of these fillers tend to come in on a more repetitive basis as well. That breaks up your sentence structure so much that it actually becomes very difficult for judges to hear and understand. This is particularly problematic because as you keep speaking faster and faster, your brain can't keep up all the time. And that's one of the reasons why you end up saying half a sentence, realize that you've said the wrong thing, and then having to backtrack and start that sentence all over again. So ironically, by going fast, you're actually going slower. So by taking the time to be more measured in your delivery, you make sure that people really can pick out everything that you say. You're able to think a little bit clearly about the sentence that you wish to articulate and then say it. And that makes it a lot more precise, which actually ends up allowing you to deliver your speech faster. The second element you can control is your volume. It's a simple thing, but some debaters don't realize that when you're speaking at a very high volume, and this could be due to adrenaline or it's your natural speaking pattern or rate, but it's not effective all the time. Some rooms are very echoey, and sometimes you're placed very close to judges as well. And when you end up just shouting at that point in time, you will end up causing basically ear pain for the judges. And that makes it very difficult for them to be comfortable and be able to hear what you're saying properly. But if your volume is too soft and you're basically whispering some of these points, you're mumbling, and they cannot make out what you are saying, then that's another problem. And this is going to be a speech which is about 50% transmission just because you were not speaking up. The third element that you in more is the number of pauses that you can introduce. Pauses are a natural pattern of human speech. In fact, it's reflected in written communication by punctuation with commas and full stops. They're designed to make you stop and let the listener process what you're saying to make sure that they have full comprehension. And when you have those pauses, it gives the judge that split second to be able to digest what's happening and then say, okay, I get the core of the argumentation that is being made. If you don't give that pause and you're immediately moving on, then the brain doesn't have that time to reflect and it's always going to have to keep just processing, writing down, etc. Which is often why you find that some judges were not even processing throughout the entire match because they were just so busy having to write everything down throughout the whole match. And the only time that they can start thinking about what was said and evaluating these points is at the end of the match using their notes. And that already means that they're having to use their recall and their memory rather than the immediate evaluation and digesting of what you've said in the sentence prior. We can afford to add a little bit more pauses. Finally, grammar and pronunciation. I know this is a touchy issue because some people feel that we are now going to be unfair to individuals who are learning English as a foreign language or as a second language. But as someone who only picked up English at the age of 10, I feel that it is a responsibility, even for ESL and EFL speakers, to master proper grammar and pronunciation. It is a language that we have to get right. Because if you have an unorthodox grammar structure, I might not understand what you're trying to say. So it makes complete sense for Singaporeans to question a policy to say, that might not make any sense to an American or to an Australian. So we have to make sure that, you know, these colloquialism or unorthodox grammar structures are eliminated, and we want to keep it to proper grammar as much as possible. The second thing is the pronunciation part. And again, it's not about accent, but we have to make sure at least that we have the proper pronunciation so that there won't be any misinterpretation of the words that you're trying to use. Just a burden that you have to make sure that you are as clear as possible. There must have been moments at the end of debates when the judge is pointing something out that you failed to do and you were pretty sure you said it. However, something that was said is not necessarily always heard, and understood exactly as you mean it to be. This is why clarity should be a key criteria for what makes for good start. Let's talk about the second criteria, how to make your speech more convincing. This is a criteria that recognizes that human beings are persuaded not only by logic and arguments, but also at an emotive and psychological level. So if a speaker these two elements to augment your argumentation, then you're even more effective as a communicator and as an advocate. When it comes to convincing someone, I like to think of these four elements as being very important. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. There are other methods, but I want to focus on these four because these are very easy for everyone to control, and they're usually the most important as well. The first one is word choice. That means that you're very careful about the words that you use because a lot of these words carry different levels of emotional resonance and have different connotations. You can say that a policy that you're opposing is bad, or you can say that that policy is genocidal, that policy is tragic, that policy is sinful. Just changing that word leads to different levels of accusation that you are throwing at your opponent, and let us gauge how seriously, you know, dangerous this particular policy can be. The second element is tone. This is where you have the ability to convey your emotion even if your words don't matter. It's purely through volume, pitch, emphasis. All of this can actually convey meaning, regardless of the words that you use. This is why you are able to pick up the emotive state of someone else whose language you do not understand, simply by picking up on what that person sounds like and being able to pick up on the tone. So you can suddenly sound very angry. What is happening here? But you're very happy because finally, a problem that plagued your society is being solved by your very policy. Thank goodness for that. So the tone comes across, and this is something that you can use to convey that emotive state and hopefully to get the audience and the judges to feel the same way that you do as a speaker. The third methodology and element is gestures, and you can add posture as well. Human beings have evolved to use nonverbal communications because we like to use all of our senses to get information in. Our eyes are very powerful, but when it comes to debate speeches, we are using a secondary method of conveying information, which is orally. So our eyes are still very distracted by gestures and posture. So we want to have control over our gestures and postures. We do not want to just have our hands waving around for every single thing that we say, or just having repeated motions such as just chopping the air. We want to use our hands to perhaps augment what we say. If we want to show that there is a glass ceiling for women in the workplace, you can literally show a glass ceiling with your palm, right, raised into the air. You can use your fingers to count 1, 2, 3 for the 3 points that you wish to convey. So it's about controlled gestures. In the same way, your body will be bigger than your hands. So if your posture is not under control, that can become quite distracting. sometimes at a subconscious level, sometimes consciously, we tend to be full of adrenaline and energy, so we sometimes rock in position, just moving back and forth almost as if we're doing some sort of square dancing or line dancing. And that can be quite distracting as well. So we want to make sure that our posture and movement is controlled. You want to stand still so that they're not distracted. And if you want to move, it should be purposeful movement, such as moving from one direction to the other if you want to signal that you're moving on to a different point, and if your lectern and your speaking position allows you to have that kind of movement as well. So controlled gestures and posture. And finally, I want to talk about connections. A little bit vague, so let me explain. When you start speaking, you want to establish some sort of emotional connection and a relationship between the listener and the speaker. This is a relationship of your own choosing. So you might want to establish the fact that you know about this topic more than anyone else, so that they treat you as a figure of authority and will trust your every word. If the motion, for instance, is on immigration, I start my speech by saying that I'm an immigrant. That puts me in position as someone who is an authority figure. People are more likely to trust what I'm saying. If the room is tense and I just want people to like me, I might crack a joke. If the audience feels that I can't connect with the speaker seems like he's from a different world and this is someone who is so alien, I might use something that connects me to the audience members. So for instance, a typical group of young people listening to me would be like, well, why is his grandfather talking to us? Then I would desperately talk about things that we would have in common, such as we're both fans of football clubs, we are actually playing video games, and we're playing the same video games online, like Call of Duty Warzone, and that's the sort of thing that establishes a sense of unity, right, between the speaker and the listener. You can also create a sympathetic response from these audience members by highlighting what a fool you are. A lot of self-effacing jokes. You are unable, for instance, to find any success in the romantic department. And when they pity you, they might actually see you as an underdog and will be rooting for you as well. So this is another way in which you can essentially elicit an emotional response, and that connection turns your speech into a very human one and can then become very convincing. I want to talk about the state of style in today's debate circuit. But before we do that, let's go back to the 1930s and how debating was done then. This is a clip from the movie called The Great Debaters. Here, representatives Wiley College are debating against Harvard on the topic of civil disobedience.
Gandhi believes one must always act with love and respect for one's opponents, even if they are Harvard debaters. Gandhi also believes that lawbreakers must accept the legal consequences for their actions. Does that sound like anarchy? Civil disobedience is not something for us to fear. It is, after all, an American concept. You see, Gandhi draws his inspiration not from a Hindu scripture, but from Henry David Thoreau, who I believe graduated from Harvard and lived by a pond not too far from here.
My opponent is right about one thing. Thoreau was a Harvard grad, and like many of us, a bit self-righteous. He once said, "Any man more right than his neighbors constitutes a majority of one." Thoreau, the idealist, could never know that Adolf Hitler would agree with his words. The beauty and the burden of democracy is this: no idea prevails without the support of the majority. The people decide the moral issues of the day, not a majority of one.
Majorities do not decide what is right or wrong. Your conscience does. So why should a citizen surrender his or her conscience to a legislator? Or
we must never, ever kneel down before the tyranny of a majority.
And now we'll have a look at the University of Berkeley going up against Harvard in a more recent edition of the same format.
At the top of the report, remember they have never answered the substantive disadvantage whatsoever means a vote for the affirmative equals a vote for extinction. This should make it a lot harder for you to include the any value to life arguments or calculations. You can concede a lot of reason why extinction outweighs all their offensive arguments. The reason why extinction doesn't outweigh because there would be no value to life in a world in which we postpone all ethical and moral considerations. And they say it's not political action that feeds our Togerson argument that says the failure to embrace the politics causes totalitarianism. And they say that the failure of politics is totalitarianism. We solve the totalitarianism impacts because we reopen the sphere of the political and don't let it merely be used as technocratic rule. Our 1AC Zimmerman evidence is phenomenal. About the ways that authoritarianism is institutionalized through technology. Instead of second argument, a double bind this option to absolute sovereignty takeout, they don't use political action as a route, they use political action as a route to inhibit rethinking. Their next argument is that we use political action as a route to rethinking, which takes out a paradox argument, but our McWhorter evidence smokes theirs. It is the part of the book that is after the cards that they read. The political action is part of the paradoxical strategy that we solve. Doing nothing is not enough.
So, those were two debates in the exact same format, the American policy debate format. But the difference is that one was from the 1930s and the other is from the 2000s. Now, we don't have actual footage of debates from the 1930s. That's very unfortunate. But this is a faithful reproduction of how that debate would have been carried out in the 1930s. So what differences do you notice? Well, the first thing that comes to mind, surely, is the speed. It was very slow back in the 1930s, and it was a lot easier to digest. Whereas speaking very fast has become almost a representative feature of the policy debate format now, where they're speaking like 600 words per minute, and it's actually become almost a point of pride for these individuals. The other thing that you'll notice was the way in which they were representing their content. The modern team is just getting the point across as literally as possible, and they want to be as straightforward. Whereas the olden team was using a lot of metaphors, similes, making references to analogies that they've seen before to try to create that greater emotive response. And I think that the lasting thing you can see in the two would be how team from the 30s was really playing to the audience inside that theater in Harvard, and also to the individuals listening on the radio and their relatives as well. Whereas the speakers from the 2000s didn't really seem to care that much about the audience. They just wanted to get through the material as much as possible. So what happened to the state of style? Debating became a success. More people started practicing it on a regular basis. It no longer became an infrequent activity where people with nothing to do during the Great Depression gathered to listen to, but that may have hurt it as well. As more and more people started debating, that meant that each room got smaller. The average debate essentially became you, your teammate, your opponents, and your judge. And with that, you tend to have more specialized knowledge, and debaters would start developing their own mannerisms, your own special language, and increasingly it becomes inaccessible to the general public. And by the end, you will notice that only debaters and judges can figure out what is happening inside a debate room. Imagine a debate that you're taking part in. If your friends who are not debaters or your family members happen to be in the room, will they understand what is happening? Will they support you and cheer because they really believe in what they were hearing, or just because they were your friends and family? I think that it is unfortunate that debating essentially has become this esoteric that unless you're a member of the community, you really cannot even be understood. There's a second reason behind this development. Debating can be seen as two different philosophies. There is debate as education, and there is debate as competition. Now, what's the difference between the two? Debate as education recognizes that we're using this particular activity, just like any other activity, it could be football, it could be art, to further our learning goals. That means that we're basically trying to create critical thinking, public speaking skills, etc. So competition is only the means to an end, not the end in itself. That's why you put a lot more emphasis on putting different categories so that we can give feedback on each of those categories so that the learning value of the activity remains very high. But when you have debate primarily as a competition, then you're putting a little bit less emphasis on pure learning. It's really more about making sure that we have a fair basis for analyzing who won and who lost. And that's about it. It's about the competition in itself. And when you start to put more emphasis on debate as competition, then you will necessarily reduce the utilization of style, etc., because it just isn't that important anymore. One example of how we've seen this development is actually inside the British parliamentary and Asian parliamentary scoring criteria. Not too long ago, they also had distinct scoring criteria called method, which is essentially style, content, and strategy. However, we've moved away from that for these two formats, and now you tend to only receive one holistic score at the end of the match, which is important for debate as competition because you need to know how well you're scoring, but you don't get that breakdown of where you're not performing well enough, which is not really that relevant to the competition, but is actually essential for you to learn and improve in the areas that you may be weak in. And this is one of the ways by which we've seen style evolved and unfortunately become de-emphasized in the modern debate circuit. You might have noticed this when you debate. When it comes to providing feedback from the judges, quite a number of the judges are not even bothering about style. They might often say something like, "Style was equally good on both sides, and let's just get straight to the issues." So even if style was equally good, we may have had different reasons why one team was better on style in one area and the other team was better on style in another area, but it's just not talked about. And in some extreme cases, we're now even hearing about judges who are not willing to judge on style at all, even though they are in the World Schools Debating Championships format. So for instance, I've actually noticed judges sometimes fill out the scoring sheet even before the debate has started by putting essentially the average score, 28, on every single speaker's style column. And I asked him, "Why are you doing that? You haven't even heard the speakers." Then he said, "Well, I don't believe in this and I can't reach on style anyway, so I'm just going to give everyone 28s. And a consequence of the judges de-emphasizing style is that the coaches themselves naturally don't feel the need to put any emphasis on style. And they feel that since this is something that isn't going to give us any more marginal points, right? Training on style doesn't give you any higher style points, then you might as well try to replace that with the categories that's going to give you more points. So that's content. And you essentially start focusing on just adding more and more content into the speech, which usually comes at the expense of style. Do I think this is a good development? Personally, no. Here is why. I think that you recall my earlier example of MFA, where my debate experiences actually ended up harming my working life. And I don't want that outcome for all of the debaters out there. A few things happen when we de-emphasize style. One, you are no longer that aware of the audience and you don't keep them in mind and the way that they might react when we end up speaking in the future. We could be talking to our bosses, our clients, and other types of individual, and they may all be looking for different things and doing different things in reaction to your speech. Bosses, unlike your judges and opponents, they are not going to be furiously writing down everything you say on a piece of paper with pen, right? They're just going to kick back, put their feet up, and listen. So you cannot matter dump on them. You have to make sure that the points are very clear and you may need constant repetition to drive across that point. A client is not always going to be coming to you in a neutral mindset like a judge. The client is already disinclined to spend money, and if you're trying to sell something to that client, you're going to have to use other methods of persuasion. And if you are in an interview, for instance, the interviewer may be trying to ask about your suitability for a college at a psychological level, whether you are actually someone who is conversant in English, all of these things, rather than just your ability to make argumentation. Same thing for a scholarship as well. So being aware of the audience and what they might want puts you in a much stronger position to respond to their needs. And to do that, you need to have a much stronger appreciation of style, because style is about keeping the audience in mind and being able to react properly to them as well. Now, for those people, at least you can still get across your ideas in a very rational way. But there's another area where logic just won't do the job anymore. When it comes to things like political discussions and the state of our society, unfortunately, the gap between people on different ends of the political spectrum are getting wider and wider, and the discussions are getting more animated and they're getting more hostile. So it's quite clear that if these groups want to be able to have proper discourse, you are going to have to learn methods of persuasion which are not based purely on rationality and logic, but have the ability to use emotive and psychological tools to create empathy, more understanding, so that we might be able to find common ground. Another reason why I want style to be emphasized is so that students have a much stronger meta-understanding of debate and other extracurricular activities. Unfortunately, some people are still in the activity only to gather trophies or to just build up that resume and make sure that you have an impressive CV. But they kind of lose sight of the bigger picture, that this was an activity that was supposed to build up our skill sets so that we are much better equipped to deal with communicating effectively in the future when our debating days are done. So that is why I continue to put a heavy premium on improving style when it comes to debate. But that's for the future. What about now? Does style help with debate right now? If, as I have said, the judges don't really seem to care about it, it still does. Here's how. One, style actually helps your content and your strategy. If you're not clear in your delivery, then you're not able to get your content and your strategy heard by the judges. And if they can't hear you, they can't reward you. So at the very least, you want to get this out. There are still many judges who are very conscious of you using style in a very deliberate manner. And if that's the case, they are definitely going to reward you as well. The second reason why you want to do this is that your style means that your speeches are now going to be effective at a subconscious level, at an emotional and psychological level. Now, that means that the judges can be affected. They may just like you more. They may enjoy your speech more. They may feel that you're more confident. But the same thing can happen with your opponents. When you are very comfortable out there, you are delivering speeches with jokes, you are throwing out personal anecdotes, they also feel that you are a speaker that is very strong and powerful, then they're intimidated. And this can be a very powerful boost to the morale of your teammates. And this is another reason why you want to incorporate better style into your speaking. And finally, if we are very conscious of learning style as a distinct category of debate, then we're going to be able to learn better. In the absence of deliberate coaching for style, we will revert to the natural way that we learn as human beings, which is to copy. We see other people, we know that they tend to get higher scores, and then we just basically try to sound like them. So we become copycats. Now, what's the problem with that? Their styles might not be suitable to the way that you speak. It could be that an angrier style works better for you, but the one that you chose to copy is not like that. It's very slow and deliberate. It could be that you might sound better if you adopted a more personal approach, but you ended up copying someone who's very aggressive and tends to be yelling all the time. Even if there was a happy coincidence and you ended up copying a style from someone else that works, you essentially end up having only one style in debating, and you end up with just one trick pony. So you can't adjust when the motions call for a different approach, when the audience calls for a different approach. So one common belief is that a lot of debaters just sound so angry all the time, and it's not because of our emotional state. We're pretty happy people, I hope. But it's just that the way that we speak, regardless of the topic, tends to be angry yelling. And this is how we tend to sound to other people all the time.
I don't know what we're yelling about! Loud noises!
So how do we improve our style? To do so, there are three different types of activities that you can engage in that will actually make your style better. The first one will be style emphasis competitions. That means that you don't focus your activities purely on your debate format, but you're willing to experiment and engage in other type of competitions where style is a heavy point of emphasis. So this is exactly the same as someone who does a triathlon. Now you've got running, you've got swimming, and you've got the bicycle. But in order to improve one particular component, you may actually want to enter into a competition that is purely swimming or that is purely running so that you can improve that particular part of your overall approach to debate. The second type of activity would be to create style supporting conditions. This really deals with the day of the debate itself and how you can prepare the room and the environment and yourself to put yourself in the best position to be stylistic. And finally, we want to talk about style drills. These are the small practices that you can actually do on your own outside of competition during practice time to improve your stylistic approach to debate. Let's talk about them one by one. So let's talk about style emphasis competitions. There are so many different competitions where style does have a huge emphasis. The first type will be pure oratory competitions. Now, this could be the Plain English Speaking Award, which is organized by the YMCA in Singapore. It could be ACJC's Orators Trophy. And you will see speeches that are not putting the emphasis on argumentation, but on your delivery and how effective you are in reaching out to the audience. Here's a sample, and this is from the original oratory format, which is very common on the American high school debate circuit.
In April of last year, I was in my living room watching a Black Lives Matter demonstration unfold on TV. Protesters demanded justice in one corner while police stared solemnly from the other. And that's when something unforgettable happened. Now, seemingly out of nowhere, a young woman emerged from the crowd, boldly approached an officer, and handed him a peace offering. Now, the whole world seemed to hold its breath as she claimed her Tiananmen Square moment. And I, along with millions, wondered who exactly this brave soul was. And that's when I realized, that's Kendall Jenner. Noted Kardashian reality star turned supermodel, starring in a Pepsi commercial. You know, I don't even need to tell you what happened next, because you know that upon receiving their Pepsis, both protesters and police became one. Dancing, high-fiving, singing a Kardashian kumbaya. And now, I am pleased to announce that Black lives finally matter.
You can also take part in different debate formats. So some debate formats actually have a little bit more emphasis on your stylistic delivery, but it's not just the fact that the scoring puts emphasis on style, but that the format itself requires you to be a lot more stylistic. So we're gonna have a look at something called the extemporaneous speech format, where These debaters essentially have to respond to a topic or a motion, prepare for 30 minutes without any research notes previously available, but they then have to deliver it without using any notes at all. And when you're not using any notes, then you are going to be a lot more engaging with the audience members. Have a look.
In one of the most classic episodes of arguably the most classic TV show of all time, SpongeBob SquarePants. SpongeBob, the main character, and his buddy Patrick Starr go around their hometown of Bikini Bottom and set literally every building inside of the city on fire. After the deed is done, SpongeBob and Patrick walk to the middle of the city, where SpongeBob looks around at all of the burning buildings collapsing to the ground and says, "Patrick, we did it. We saved the city." This is exactly the US's approach and response to the current war in Afghanistan. Because despite the fact that a war has currently been going on in Afghanistan for the last 16 years, and the US has been involved for 16 years, we're still having to ask the question today as to whether or not this war was a failure. In fact, on June 15th of 2017, Reuters reported that President Donald Trump made the executive decision to send 4,000 more US troops to the nation of Afghanistan. And upon understanding that this conflict has been long-lasting, intensifying over recent years, and the US is only getting more and more involved, it's crucial that we reflect, analyze, and ask the question, was the US war in Afghanistan in vain? The answer to which is an unfortunate no, because the conflict has only intensified despite US action, as we'll understand by looking to three key areas of analysis. First, we'll understand the US has a simple-minded, myopic perspective on the current Afghan conflict. Second, we'll see the US's proposed solution, troop surges, have been a disastrous failure at bringing Taliban to the negotiating table for peace. And third, we'll see that the proof is in the pudding. Despite US action and intensifying US action, the conflict inside of Afghanistan has only gotten worse.
And finally, you can also modify your current debate format so that it will actually force you to put the emphasis on style. So for instance, you can modify the World Schools Debating Championship format in something that I like to call the Green Cup format. Now that means that you're not allowed to use any paper or notes during the preparation, during the debate to take down notes, and you are not allowed to use notes to deliver your speech. I sometimes make it even more interesting by telling the judges that they themselves cannot take any notes down. So they have to sit there and listen as if they were bosses listening to you in the future. That completely changes the way that you prepare your points, the way that you recall your points, deliver the points, and you're also very conscious of the fact that the judges cannot actually take any notes. So you find yourself keeping yourself a lot more conversational, making sure that they remember the key points rather than just dumping the matter on the judges. And those are some of the types of competitions that you can actually enter into to improve your style. Now let's talk about style supporting conditions. How can we create a physical environment during the debate that is conducive to style? There is, of course, an infinite list of things that you can do, but here are three examples which are very useful. One, be mindful of the type of notes that you want to use as a visual aid, because you have the option of using cards, books, or paper, and each one of them can have an impact on the way that you speak. I'll give you an example. Let's say you're using a sheet of paper that is A4 size, and when you actually write the notes, you're doing so while seated, and so approximately 30 centimeters away from your eyes would be your notes. So your handwriting size is the size that you might be able to see here. But the moment you stand up to speak, you'll notice that the notes are actually on the table, which is at your waist, but you're standing up. So the distance between the sheet of paper and your eyes essentially has doubled. And as you can see, it's a lot harder to read. That might necessitate that you keep having to look down, your voice is directed at the table, and you basically can't have eye contact with the judges and the audience members anymore. And this can actually be stifling to your stylistic delivery, which is one of the reasons why teams like the National Team of Singapore, the members are encouraged to use cards so that you're basically forced to get your points in very large font with very few words. And that actually helps with the speech and eye contact. The second thing you can control is the room itself. That can involve things like turning the fans down so you can be heard, etc. So you should do that. But this is also very useful, controlling the distance from the judges. So a lot of speakers tend not to want to adjust to where a table or a lectern was set for you, and they just speak from there, even if it doesn't suit their style. So what you want to do is to recognize, as shown in the table here, that there is actually different types of spacing that we can have that leads to you having different volumes of engagement. If you're in a very small personal sphere, you tend to lower your volume, and or you should anyways. And if you have a much wider space, then you will naturally tend to orate a little bit more. If you don't control it, you might end up with a very inappropriate type of style. You could be put very far away from someone because the room is large, but you're still in a very soft conversational voice. Or you could be literally 1 meter away from the judge and you're still screaming at them. So if you can, you need to adjust the distance between you and the judges, usually by moving back a little or forward. But if you can't do that, then you need to adjust the way that you deliver the speech so that it's more appropriate for the distance. The third thing that you can control as part of the conditions is warming up your voice, warming up your muscles in your face and your throat that will be necessary for a smooth and powerful delivery. This is something that singers and people in theatre and drama appreciate, something that I'm sure you would appreciate. You probably would not want to start performing Shakespeare on stage without doing rehearsal, without doing some sort of warm-ups before your speech itself. But debaters tend not to do that. They spend the entire period of preparation, be it 15, 30 or 60 minutes, essentially just discussing and writing the case, and they don't bother to rehearse. So the speech doesn't always come out very clear. Here are some warm-ups that you can actually use, and it's actually very fun, might look a little bit silly, but they're actually very effective, and they have been used by singers and people in theatre and public speakers, politicians, to make sure that when they deliver that speech, it comes out pitch perfect. You can use these before the motion comes out and you have time to do some sort of prior preparation. Once you have the motion and you've already crafted your speech, then you should be doing a different type of warm-up, which is to rehearse with that very speech so that you can deliver it with stylistic aplomb on the floor itself.
Hi, I'm Greg Justice from the Department of Theatre and Cinema. I do workshops all over the country on improving communication effectiveness. Part of it is warming up your voice. Let's go! Big face. Little face. Big face. Little, left, right, up, down. Now, yawn. Yawn again. We speak with our lips, warm them up. We use our tongue for articulation. If you got tension in your neck, head rolls. Yeah. Other way. Yeah. Don't forget your articulators. Patika 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 patika. Patika 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 patika. Maninga 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 maninga. Backwards. Ganama ganama ganama. Katapa katapa katapa. Gadaba gadaba gadaba. And then finish with tongue twisters. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. A peck of pickled peppers. Peter Piper picked. If Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, how many peppers would Peter Piper pick? That's how you start warming up your voice. Ta-da!
The third component are drills. This is where you work with a coach or your teammates or just by yourself to improve your style. Again, I've got 3 suggestions here, but it's the non-exhaustive list and there's so many other practices that you can have. But one of the most effective ways of improving your style is self-assessment. That means that you videotape yourself, you listen to your speech, and you also look at the way that you're standing and you're moving in order to get an idea of how the audience and the judges are actually seeing you and hearing you and making the adjustments as you go along. All of us now have access to a video camera of some sort within the house because of all the phones we have available. So this is the tool that we should be using a lot more frequently to get that self-assessment. If you suspect that you're missing some things or that you don't even notice that you might be doing something that others are, then bring a friend in so that they can actually have a look at that video or look at you debating and then say that, here is a stylistic element that you may want to change. The second type would be doing drills specifically to improve your vocal muscles and to be able to deliver with much more confidence and clarity. And to do this, there's a whole bunch of public speaking, theater, and singing drills that you can actually implement. So you can just Google for them and you can find things like putting a pencil in your mouth to speak with an obstacle. You can find the use of tongue twisters, etc. So it's a very long list, but you should start focusing on improving the nature of your delivery, right? And by putting emphasis on your vocal quality. And this is a second way that you can drill your voice. The third type of drilling is actually going to involve a bit of research because it's about finding good material for your speeches. As this is especially important for the starts of your speeches when you're trying to create that fantastic first impression. And to do so, if you have fantastic quotes that let people know that, wow, this guy is going to sound awesome, this girl is amazing. If you have jokes that shows that you're a funny speaker, that you are very comfortable with the situation, that you can even afford to crack jokes, or if you have stories, personal anecdotes that allow you to establish whatever relationship you want with the audience members, then it will make your speech, regardless of the topic, so much more interesting. And this is the sort of practices that you should be implementing. Self-assessment, vocal drills, and finding that good material. And that's it. We've come to the end of the video. As I mentioned earlier, this wasn't meant to be a series of drills where I just teach you every single thing that we can do to improve our style. That will take way too long, and this is really something for everyone to explore. I just wanted everyone to have this appreciation of style, why it's so important. And to summarize, style makes for clear and convincing speeches. They'll be so much better, and we now know what we're going for when we say we want good style. We know that style is going to make you a much more effective communicator in the real world past our debating prime. And even if we're not looking at that point in time, style is going to improve in debate competitions right now. And that's why you should already start putting a lot more emphasis on it. And finally, we talked a little bit about how we can improve our style through competitions, conditions, and drills. If we want to learn more about style, then we will have future sessions where we can actually go in depth, and I welcome all of your feedback and your questions and comments. But for now, this is me, Sam, signing off. Stay stylish, stay awesome.